Lorax, by Dr. Seuss.
At the far end of town where the green cool grass grows, and the wind smells slow and sour when it blows, and no birds ever sing excepting old crows, is the street of the lifted Lorax. And deep in the green cool grass, some people say, if you look deep enough, you can still see today where the Lorax once stood, just as long as it could, before somebody lifted the Lorax away.
What was the Lorax, and why was it there, and why was it lifted and taken somewhere? From the far end of town where the grinkle grass grows, the old Onceler still lives here.
Ask him. He knows.
You won't see the Onceler. Don't knock at his door.
He stays in his lurkum on top of his store.
He lurks in his lurkum cold under the roof,
where he makes his own clothes out of miff-muffered moof. And on special dank midnights in August, he peeks out of the shutters, and sometimes he speaks and tells how the Lorax was lifted away. He'll tell you, perhaps, if you're willing to pay. On the end of a rope, he lets down a tin pail, where you have to toss in 15 cents, a nail, and the shell of a great-great-great-grandfather snail. Then he pulls up the pail, makes a most careful count to see if you paid him the proper amount. Then he hides what you paid him away in his snuff, his secret strange hole in his groovyless glove. Then he grunts, I will call you by whisper my phone, for the secrets I tell are for your ears alone. Slup, down slups the whisper my phone to your ear, and the old Onceler's whispers are not very clear, since they have to come down through a snoodly hose, and he sounds as if he had smallish bees up his nose. Now I'll tell you, he says, with his teeth sounding gray, how the Lorax got lifted and taken away. It all started way back, such a long, long time back, way back in the days when the grass still green, the pond was still wet, and the clouds were still clean, and the song of the Swami swans rang out in space. One morning I came to see this glorious place, and I first saw the trees, the truffula trees, the bright colored tufts of the truffula trees, mile after mile in the fresh morning breeze. And under the trees I saw brown barbalutes frisking about in their barbalute suits as they played in the shade and ate truffula fruits. From the rippleless pond came a comfortable sound of the humming fish humming while splashing around. But those trees, those truffula trees, all my life I've been searching for trees such as these. The touch of their tufts was softer than silk, and they had the sweetest smell of fresh butterfly milk. I felt a great leaping of joy in my heart. I knew just what I'd do. I unloaded my cart. In no time at all, I built a small shop, and I chopped down a truffula tree in one chop. And with great skillful skill, and with great speedy speed, I took a small tuft and knit it unkneed. The instant I'd finished, I heard a gazump. I looked, and I saw something pop out of the stump of the tree I chopped down. It was some sort of man. Describe him? It's hard. I don't know if I can. He was shortish and oldish and brownish and mussy, and he spoke with a voice that was sharpish and bossy. Mister, he said with a sawdusty sneeze, I am the Lorax. I speak for the trees. I speak for the trees, for the trees have no tongues, and I'm asking you, sir, at the top of my lungs. He was very upset as he shouted and puffed, what is that thing you've made out of my truffula tuft?
Look, Lorax, I said, there's no cause for alarm. I chopped just one tree. I'm doing no harm.
I'm being quite useful. This thing is a kneed. A kneed is a fine something that all people need. It's a shirt, it's a sock, it's a glove, it's a hat. It has other uses. Yes, far beyond that. You can use it for carpets, for pillows, for sheets, or curtains, or covers for bicycle seats.
The Lorax said, sir, you're crazy with greed. There is no one on earth who would buy that fool kneed. For the very next minute, I proved he was wrong. For just at that minute, a champ came along, and he thought that the kneed I had knitted was great, and he happily bought it for $3.98. I laughed at the Lorax. You poor stupid guy. You never can tell what some people will buy.
I repeat, cried the Lorax, I speak for the trees. I'm busy, I told him. Shut up, if you please.
I rushed across the room, and in no time at all, but a radio phone, I put in a quick call. I called my brothers and uncles and aunts, and I said, listen here, here's a wonderful chance for the whole Onceler family to get mighty rich. Get over here fast, take a road to North Niche. Turn left at Weehawken. Sharp right at South Snitch. And in no time at all, in a factory I built, the whole Onceler family was working full tilt. We were all knitting kneed,
just as busy as bees to the sound of the chopping of truffula trees. Then, oh, baby, oh, how the business did grow. Now, chopping one tree at a time was too slow. So I quickly invented the super axe hacker, which whacked off 4 truffula trees in 1 smacker. And that Lorax, he didn't show up anymore. But the next week, he knocked at my new office door. He snapped, "I'm the Lorax. I speak for the trees, which you seem to be chopping as fast as you'd please. But I'm also in charge of the brown barbalutes, who played in the shade in their barbalute suits and happily lived eating truffula fruits. Now, thanks to your hacking my trees to the ground, there's not enough truffula fruits to go around. And my poor barbalutes are getting the crummies, because they have gas and no food in their tummies. They loved living here, but I can't let them stay. They'll have to find food, and I hope that they may. Good luck, boys," he cried, and he sent them away. I, the Onceler, felt sad, but I watched them all go. But business is business, and business must grow, regardless of crummies and tummies, you know? I meant no harm. I most truly did not, and I had to grow bigger, so bigger I got. I biggered my factory, I biggered my roads, I biggered my wagons, I biggered my loads. Of the canids I shipped out, I was shipping from forth, to the south, to the east, to the west, to the north. I went right to biggering, selling more canids. I biggered my money, which everyone needs. Then again he came back. I was fixing some pipes when that old nuisance Lorax came back with more grapes. I am the Lorax, he coughed and he whiffed. He sneezed and he snuffled, he snored and he sniffed. Onceler, he cried with a cruffulous croak. Onceler, you're making such smunculous smoke. My poor swami swans, why, they can't sing a note. No one can sing when they have smog in their throat. And so, said the Lorax, please pardon my cough. They cannot live here, so I'm sending them off. Where will they go? I don't hopefully know. They may have to fry for a month or a year to escape the smog you have smogged up around here. What's more, snapped the Lorax. His danger was up. Let me say a few words about Glumpity Glump. Your machinery chugs on day and night without stop, making Gloppity Glop, also Sclopity Sclop. And what do you do with this leftover goo? I'll show you, you dirty old Onceler man, you. You're glumping the pond where the humming fish hummed. No more can they hum, for their gills are all gummed. So I'm sending them off. Oh, their future is dreary. They'll walk on their fins and get woefully weary, and search for some water that isn't so smeary. And then I got mad. I got terribly mad. I yelled at the Lorax. Now listen here, Dad. All you do is yap, yap, and say bad, 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 bad. Well, I have my rights, sir, and I'm telling you. I intend to go on doing just what I do. And for your information, you Lorax, I'm figuring on biggering and biggering and biggering and biggering and biggering, turning more truffula trees into canids, which everyone, everyone, everyone needs. And at that very moment, we heard a loud whack. From outside in the fields came a sickening smack of an axe on a tree. Then we heard the tree fall, the very last truffula trees of them all. No more trees, no more canids, no more work to be done. So in no time, my uncles and aunts, everyone, they waved goodbye. They jumped into my cars and drove away under the smoke-smuggered stars. And all that was left neath the bad-smelling sky was my big, empty factory, the Lorax, and I. The Lorax said nothing, just gave me a glance, just gave me a very sad, sad backward glance. And he lifted himself by the seat of his pants, and I'll never forget the grim look on his face when he hoisted himself and took leave of this place through a hole in the smug without leaving a trace. And all that the Lorax left here in this mess was a small pile of rocks with the one word unless. Whatever that meant, well, I just couldn't guess. That was long, long ago. But each day since that day, I've sat here and worried away. Through the years while my buildings have fallen apart, I've worried about it with all of my heart. But now, said the Onceler, now that you're here, the word of the Lorax seems perfectly clear. Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing is going to get better, it's not. So catch, calls the Onceler. He lets something fall. It's a truffula seed. It's the last one of all. You're in charge of the last of the truffula seeds, and the truffula trees are what everyone needs. Plant a new truffula, treat it with care, give it clean water and feed it fresh air. Grow forest, protect it from axes that hack, and the Lorax and all of his friends may come back. The end. Thank you for listening, and remember to read across America.